Good morning, everybody. My name is Danny, and I'm one of the pastors of our campus, one of our campuses. And we're supposed to start earlier, but I messed up. And so I'm going to go ahead and plug this in, which is required to help us kind of get started. So, hey, let's go ahead and stand together. There we go. It's great to start off, you know, your first time leading here in a while, and just let you know that we're all failures and we need Jesus. We believe we're real people with real issues and we need real hope. It's great to serve Jesus. And so let's go ahead and we're going to worship him today. Sing.
Waking up knowing there's a reason. All my dreams come alive. This life is worth living. With you, I made my decision. You lift me up. You lift me up, fill my eyes with wonder. Forever young in your love, this freedom's untainted. With you, Roman is wasted. Let's sing, see the sun.
That you decided to join us today on this nice sunny day, right? It's going to stay sunny. We thought it was going to rain, so we moved everything inside. Now the sun's shining. What's all good, right? Why don't you greet one another? Just turn, shake a hand, hug a neck, shake a neck, hug a hand, whatever you want to do, and then find a seat. That's enough. You guys are supposed to it going. Just kidding. We love it that everybody's connecting, and that's one of the things I love about our church here is that we do love to eat and shake hands. Amen? Yeah, so we're so glad that you decided to join us today. Welcome to One Church. If you're new here, if you're a guest, we're so glad that you decided to join us. In the seat back in front of you, we have some things there. One of them is a So You Are New card, and that information is in the back. Tells you a little bit about what is going on here, who we are, and just, you know, what's happening through our service today and that. So you can take that and take a look at that. Also in the seat back in front of you is a Connect card. And if you're a first-time guest here, we would love to know that you were here. And we have a very special gift for you, and we'd love it if you'd fill that card out if you haven't already been asked to fill that out. But if you'd fill that out and put that in the offering basket, or you could take it to the hub in the back and turn it in there, and we can get you your gift there. And if you're back again for a second time, we'd really like to have a record that you came back. And we want to greet you too, and we have a special gift for you as well. And so if you'll take that Connect card and fill it out, drop it, you can drop it in the offering if you'd like, or you can take it to the hub in the back. If you are a regular here, if you call yourself, this is your home church and you are here, we would love for you to use that Connect card to communicate with us, to put prayer requests down. You can sign up for activities there, and you can give that to one of us, take it to the hub in the back, or you can drop that into the offering as well. We have a lot that goes on around here, and hopefully you were warmly greeted when you walked in the door this morning, and you got a bulletin with all the information about what's happening in the One Church network, completely from the Bethel campus to the Ripon campus to St. John's. There's lots of things that are going on, and that's one of the ways that we communicate that information to you through that bulletin. And so you can take a look inside there, find out what's going on. There's important dates, reminders, all kinds of great stuff. Also, you can go to our Facebook page. If you are online and you have Facebook, you can go there, like us, comment there. We comment there throughout the week and update information there. But you can find out more about what's going on within One Church and within the Crossroads family right here from the Facebook page as well. But we want to draw your attention to a slight change. We've changed from the VIP area in the back to the hub. We've got, it's kind of cool. Yeah, I like that. Tracy's sign is like, you know, I wish we could make it so that when it turned on, it like flickered a little bit. You know, that would be cool. The electricity, it might just happen. So we are still working on some of that. But we've got the hub in the back, and you've got the bulletin as you came in. But inside the bulletin, we would normally have that Connect card. We would normally have an offering envelope in there. All of those things are in the seat back in front of you. And so you can reach in there. You can grab a thing there. You have to share pens right now. It's only every other chair, so not all of you can write down at the same time. But that's by design. We want you to share with each other. And so that's what's going on in that back seats there. Builds community and share in that. So be aware of that. If you need to need an offering envelope, should be in the seat back in front of you. But don't hesitate to grab one of the ushers in the back and ask for an offering envelope if you need that, or if you just need more information. If you didn't get a bulletin when you came in, we can get you one of those. There's plenty in the back. But there's a few things that we want to point out to you today so that you can be aware of them and what's coming up. We have water baptism coming up on March 20th. And if you are interested in being baptized, if you've accepted Christ and you want to take that next step in declaring your faith and dying to that old self, and you want to symbolize that through the baptism in water, we would love to have you join us for that. You can fill that out on the Connect card. You say, I want to be a part of water baptism. Drop that in the offering, or you can take it to the hub. I say that a lot. So that, or you can come and talk to one of us. Grab Pastor Tracy, grab myself, talk to Lynn in the back, one of the ushers, talk with Sheila, and just let us know, hey, I'd really like to be baptized. I want to be a part of that. What's that about? And we can give you more information and get you pointed in the right direction there. Also, we have a meet and greet coming up. If you are new to One Church and you don't know who we are or what we're about, we would love for you to join us next Sunday right after church, right in the back, for about 15 minutes, just so we can introduce ourselves to you. You can introduce yourself to us, and we have a little Q&A time so that you can ask questions and just find out how crazy we really are. And you might want to join, right? You know, crazy people, real people with real issues, you know, and we Just let it all out right there. The other thing that we've got going, Sheila, Shelly has given me a prop here. You've been egged. How many were egged last year at Easter time? It was so cool because last year, as our house got egged, my neighbor asked what this was all about. And it was really cool to be able to share with him what it was, what we were doing as a church. And he donated for kids to go to camp. And he's told us, you know, anytime you need help with kids doing anything, I'm your guy. You let me know. He was also very clear to let me know that don't ask me for anything else. But for children, I'll do anything. So, we love him. He's a great neighbor. And so it was awesome to have this out front. And that was the purpose of it. We want to raise money for kids to go to kids camp. But we also, I love the fact that it's part of the neighborhood and everybody around us is asking, what is that about? And it gives us an opportunity to share about our church and share about our faith and what we're doing. And giving to kids warms people's hearts, unless you're dead. And so, you know, anybody will see this and they'll want to be a part of it. So this is the ransom that gets put out in your front door or out in the front of your yard, and the eggs get put out all over there. We are collecting names of people that you would like to see their house egged. Not literally. Sort of literally. Figuratively and literally, but with plastic eggs. And it's really cool. It's a lot of fun. And it's $25. 20 to egg. Five to remove, 20 to move it. So if you get egged, you got $5 you have to give to get them off your lawn. $20 to take them and give it to the guy who put it on your lawn. And last week, as I was sharing with somebody at the barbecue we were having, I was like, oh, yeah, this is the egg thing. And he looked up at me, and he was like, yeah, I'll do that, and wrote my name down. So, yeah, that's happening. And so we're excited about that. So be a part of that. If the ushers could prepare for the tithe and offering, I'd appreciate that as we get ready for that. We are in just an awesome season as we get close to Easter. I know that we should be remembering Christ all the time and what he did for us. And we do that through communion today. We're going to be taking communion and remembering Christ's death and his resurrection. But this Easter season, it seems that people are so much more warming and welcome to coming to church and being a part of church. So we will be having two services coming up on Easter. That's March 28th, a 9 o'clock and a 10:40. And so we'll be telling you more about that as we go. But I also want to remind you, as we go into this Easter season, it's spring forward next week. So we're going to lose an hour. So remember that. If you get here at 9 o'clock, well, I don't know what that means. I have to think a little bit more. What does that mean? If you show up at 9 o'clock old time, you're here really late, right? Service will be over? No. It'll just be starting. I don't know. Something like that. You'll figure it out later. It's spring forward. Let's pray over the offering, though. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the giver and the money that you bring to us so that we can spread your gospel. We partnering together with each other. Lord, I thank you for the congregation here that gives so much and in abundance. They are so giving. And Lord, we thank you for that. We pray that you would bless this offering. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Has ransomed me.
Cornerstone, weak makes on His unchanging grace. And every high and stormy gale, oh, my anchor is You.
My anchor holds with Me.
Let's see that.
My anchor holds within the veil.
Let's see it.
Christ
church. We're going to sing that again. Lift your voice. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak, big, strong. We need You, God. Oh, through the storm, You today. Be the Lord of all in our lives. Oh.
Lord, it is through Your work, Your grace, and Your mercy that we stand faultless before the throne. For we have all have sinned and come short of Your glory, and are in desperate need of Your grace and Your mercy. So, Lord, we thank You today. We rejoice today that we can stand in Your presence. We can glorify Your name. We can worship You because of Your righteousness that You have put upon us, not by our own works, not by our own deeds, but by You. We say, Christ alone, our cornerstone. And we give You the praise and we give You the glory. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. You can be seated. So awesome to be here this morning. I want to tell you that we got a call last night from Pastor Shane. And a text message. You know, we don't call people nowadays, we text. You know, which I love it because I hate talking on the phone. So if I ever call you on the phone, it's going to be really short, sweet, quick. It's not because I don't like you. I just don't like talking on the phone. But we got a text message last night that they were heading to the hospital. And so I believe we have a picture at 1:30 last night. Zephaniah was born 7 pounds, 10 ounces, which I think is pretty small for a Samoan baby. But I don't know. I'm going to have to talk to Pastor Shane about that. He's here, and they're excited. And so what a blessing. He's healthy, good-looking boy there. So we're excited for them. So that's where they're at today. So keep them in prayer. Quick recovery for Mama because she has two other littles. You know, so if you've ever been in that situation where you have several littles in the house, it's quite a different task. And I can remember when I went from 2 to 3. You know, that's a magic number when you're having kids. That third one, it just throws everything off. All right, you no longer have the advantage as a parent. All right, you are outnumbered. And you don't have enough hands to keep a hold of them. So just be praying for them as they just love this new baby and they welcome him into their lives and in our lives. So it's great. So thank you for all the gifts the last couple weeks for them and the baby. I just got to brag that we not only took care of all the left gifts that they had on their registry. We had several $100, $125 extra come in that we were able to give them a gift card so they could, buy, how many know diapers? That's like the diapers and formula, if you have no investments, invest in Huggies and formula. It will forever change. I wished I would have with 7 kids. I would have been a rich man with all the investment I put into those. But so that's kind of what's happening there. Had a great week last week celebrating 1 year. Thank you for all those who served. Couldn't have done it without the whole team pitching in. So we are in week 3 of our series called The Prodigal God. And in your planner, you have some notes, and it's pretty simple notes this week. So you can kind of follow along there. You can you can write as you want. But really, I want to just kind of a quick review. You know, the first week, when we started this series, we were talking about just the extravagant love of God. And that at the heart or at the core of this parable that Jesus was teaching was not so much about the prodigal lost son or the older brother. But the heart of this, the heart of the parable, the heart of what Jesus was trying to convey to the people was the heart of the Father and his love for you, his love for me. And so that was the first week, and it came down to this, that the simple big idea is this: God loves you, period. You didn't earn it. Most of us don't even come close to deserving it. But he loves you, period. And that's if we could get that foundation as we go through and we learn more and we dive more into this parable, this story that Jesus is teaching, we got to keep that at the center and it'll help us understand and build. And then last week we kind of talked about what the setting with the insiders and the outsiders. We talked about the prodigals and the Pharisees and who he was talking to, and then the two types of people that were represented by the younger brother and the older brother was the sinners and those that were listening, tax collectors. I think that's funny. So if you work for an IRS, you're automatically in the category of a sinner. And I believe that's true. Tax collectors, and then there was the religious, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the religious leaders that were always following they wanted to follow the crowd because they couldn't figure out how they could get a crowd. You know, they couldn't get a crowd, so they were following Jesus to try to figure out. But they always were questioning him. And so that's kind of where we were the last couple weeks. So this week, as we planned this series, and we're doing this across our campuses, and as we got together, this week we had a focus, and our focus is the title there, Signs You're a Younger Brother. Signs You're a Younger Brother. Some of you just sighed a big relief, especially after last week, which that's just a sign that you're an older brother. Some of you get that later. Now that's next week. We'll talk about that next week. But, you know, since last week we had the celebration and the message, I felt like, man, Tracy, we had this one-year celebration, and you went pretty heavy on the message. How many walked out feeling a little beat up last week, that God was working you over? Nobody? Oh, well, I'm going to get serious then today. All right. So a few. Oh, Shannon's like, please don't do that again. I can't handle it. You guys look like you work for Best Buy. That's what I mean. You got the blue going on. Yeah.
Prison guards.
There you go. All right. Dave's kind of matching, too. And Mike back there, yeah, blue. I didn't get the message, I guess. So, but last week, it seemed like it was kind of heavy. So I figured this week, we need to start it out a little lighter. We need to be able to laugh a little bit. And so this week, as we go into this the message, it's really kind of the truths are going to come out of this. You might be a younger brother if. Now, does that sound familiar to anybody? Yeah, I see the rednecks going, yeah, I got it. All right, so we're going to go with that. How many know Jeff Foxworthy? All right, what is he known for? You might be a if. All right, so I got some good redneck jokes right here. And I can tell these because I are one. So before we go into this, we need to get kind of set up for this. So you might be a redneck if you think LOL means low on liquor. Hey, baby, LOL, can you run to the store? All right. You might be a redneck if you have a home that's mobile and three cars that aren't. Some of you are like, dang, how did he know? I'm going to go have to take them off the jacks today. You might be a redneck if Thanksgiving was ruined because you ran out of ketchup. You might be a redneck if your school hands out NASCAR race tickets for perfect attendance. That's for the back row right there. Why are you reaching over again? Don't, no. Oh, that's why they sit back there. You might be a redneck if you've ever used a toilet seat as a picture frame. The truth is coming out. I see it in some of your eyes. No. You might be a redneck if you think the styrofoam cooler is the greatest invention of all time. You might be a redneck if you ever use a weed eater inside. You might be a redneck or a Hawaiian if you ever barbecued spam on a grill. See, I get teased by the redneck from all the Hawaiians that I'm related to now, but you know what? They kind of go hand in hand. I've found a lot of similarities between Hawaiians and Islanders and rednecks, so I don't know. You might be a redneck if your grandma has ever been asked to leave a bingo game because of her language. Joel, why are you laughing so? No, I love it. Got to have Joel here anytime I do jokes because he likes them. He gets them. You might be a redneck if your kids are going hungry tonight because you had to have those Yosemite Sam mud flaps. You might be a redneck if you have a very special baseball cap for just formal occasions. You may be a redneck if you tape phone numbers on the back of your cell phone. If you need help on that, Danny can train you. He can show you how to put your phone numbers in the phone. And they're like, it's digital now. And it's like, you don't got to do that. You might be a redneck if you stare at a box of orange juice in the morning because it said concentrate on it. Some of you were late for work, huh? I stared at that box for an hour. Didn't do anything. Oh, all right. Well, you know, there's these signs. There's, you know, we identify people, right, by their behaviors, by their actions, by their choices. You know, and it's so easy to kind of put labels on everybody and labels, I mean, and we go, oh, well, no, I'm not, you know, I'm not prejudiced. You know, I'm not a profiler. I'm not a cop. You know, I remember I was a cop for a while. My brother's been a cop for over 20 years. You know, and we always, you know, you always heard you're profiling. Well, if it walks like a duck, looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, then maybe it's a duck. So, you know, I'd say, I used to work with teenagers, and I said, listen, if you're going to wear your pants down around your ankles with a flannel shirt, guess what cops are going to think you are? I mean, you know, and so it's easy as we go into this, and signs that you are a younger brother, it's easy to start pointing fingers. It's easy to go, oh, that's a younger brother. That, oh, look what they're doing. Look at their lifestyle. Look at the decisions they're making. It can become so easy for us to set back. As we talk about the younger son this morning, the prodigal son, what picture pops into your head? When you think about that story of that younger son, what are the images that you start seeing? Is it the tattooed, long-haired biker? The baggy pants, flannel-wearing shirt, gangbanger? The party girl that's wearing barely nothing, revealing everything? Or is it the skinny, teeth-missing drug addict? What is that picture in your head? Because we all come up with a picture. We all come up, and here's what it typically looks like. Somebody that's not like us. Right? When I think about people being lost, I think about people that don't look like me, that got major issues, bigger issues than I do. The truth of the matter is, the lost brother, the younger brother, could possibly look just like the person sitting in your seat. As I went throughout this week, we knew this was the message, and I was thinking about this message. I was struggling. I was so frustrated with this message. And yesterday I sent out a text to some of my team, and I said, I don't know what to do here. I'm struggling with this message. Why? And the question for me was, why preach a message to a church who predominantly, I would say most everybody in here knows Jesus, serving Jesus? Why preach a message on signs you're a younger brother? And I've struggled all week, so this message may not even go with your notes. I may totally jack up the next few messages in this series today. But I just struggled with it. I was like, why do we need to hear this? Why do the people that are going to come and sit here Sunday morning need to hear this message? So last night I was here at about, I don't know, it was between 4 and 6. I was here doing some projects. And I just came up here and I sat right here. And I had worship music playing. And I began to cry. Say, Lord, why? Why am I preaching this message? I felt very insecure. I was like, I don't want to get up and preach this message. I was like, Shane, don't have the baby because we may just do worship the whole time. And I sat here, and as I wept and I prayed and I asked God, what began to work inside of me was this. And some of my team responded with some of this and helped me out as I tried to clear my thoughts. And it was this. The problem with signs that you might be a younger brother or the younger son is that we want to look at all those outward things. We want to focus on the outward stuff, the things that we call sinful. And God began to work with me, and he said, Tracy, you don't know how many people are sitting there, and this is a heart issue. This is a mind and heart issue. You don't know how many, they may be one or two decisions away from walking out of the house. I said, okay, I get that, Lord, I get that. I will talk about the signs. So I want everybody today to understand some of these signs so you recognize them in your own heart, your own life, and you can recognize also that you can recognize those around you. Okay, because we get so caught up in our world, our lives, our busyness, that every day we walk by the lost without saying a word. We walk by people that are on their way to eternity without God because we're just too busy. So we need to understand signs of a lost brother. Signs that that person sitting next to us, that person that works next to us, might be lost. And as I was sitting here and I was praying here, something was happening at my house that I had no idea. Somebody who was very lost was at my doorsteps. And I'm going to ask Shelley just to come and share what happened last night and share what God just is really stirring in us about the lost.
So a woman that Tracy and I know, I'm going to call her an acquaintance. She's not really a friend. She's an acquaintance, but we run into her about once a month. And over the last every time we run into this woman, all we hear is grief. I've heard it regularly, month after month after month. I've heard, this horrible thing has happened to my daughter. My son is ill. My best friend's daughter has been diagnosed with a very, very life-threatening disease. My grandfather died. My significant other just left because his mom died and we have to buy an emergency ticket to go. This is what we've heard month after month after month. And we've ministered to them before. Last night, she's on my doorstep. And she's really skinny since the last time I've seen her. Lost a lot of weight. And she looks bad. I mean, she looks sick. And she begins to tell me again how something is going really wrong in her body. She's sick. She needs care. She doesn't have the money to pay for the care that she needs. I'm looking at her and she has bruises on her arms, and they're not like from abuse. They're bruises like when someone is ill, okay? And she's telling me how sick she is, and she's standing at my doorstep and she's crying. Now, ladies, we just came from women's conference, right? What did we hear? When you have seen Jesus, you tell the world that you have seen Jesus. And I have told this woman before, and I began to pray for her, and I began to lay hands on her, and I began to call her out. What are you doing? What are you doing? You live in an area where God has surrounded you with Christians. What are you doing? Get to the cross. Get to the cross, get to the cross, get to the cross. This is not God's purpose for you. This is not his plan for you. He doesn't want you to die in this place. What are you doing? Please let me take you to the cross. I know people that are in her family. I told her I was going to call her family, and I did. I called her family. We had a conversation. I said, go after your family. I'm going after her. You go after her. Now, I get it, guys. I understand that it's by the Holy Spirit that people are drawn to Christ. I understand that. I understand that salvation is not in my hands. Okay? But you know what? I can pick her up. I tried today. I'll try again this week. I'll try again next week, Sunday. I can put her family in the car. I can pray. I can drive. I can park my car in front of her house, and I can pray. Because my God is bigger, and I curse the plan of the enemy over that family's life in Jesus' name. This is the point. I am not going to sit by, and I hope nobody in this room does either. Because you know what? She knows Jesus. She told me she does. But somehow, she doesn't know Jesus like I do. The God that heals. Right? The God that heals. So, when Tracy came home, we had a quick conversation about this, and I'll wrap this up right here. And there's this sense of, well, God gave us choice, right? I mean, she has to choose the Lord, right? Just to make that decision for herself, right? But this is my own personal decision. When I'm put in a situation like that and the Lord wants to use me, and even if I'm not sure if the Lord wants to use me, I know what my call is. I'm going for it, okay? Because I don't leave my paralyzed friend on the side of the road and say, hey, you need to make a choice for Jesus. I drag them to the top of the roof. We pull the roof off. We drop that person in front of the Lord, and we get them as close to Jesus as they can, as we can in our humanness, so that they can make a choice for the Lord. So pray for me this week. Pray for that family this week. I'm believing for a miracle there.
We have to understand the lost. Because if we're not reaching the lost, like Jesus reached the lost, then we're missing the whole point of his redeeming story. We're missing the whole point of communion today. It's not about our comfort in a comfy church. It's about reaching the lost. We need to recognize those signs, and our hearts should break. This young woman has something going on in her mouth. There's a disease, and it could be life-threatening, and she can't afford the surgery. So we're trying to figure out, how do we take care of this? This is not, I'm not trying to get money from anybody. I'm just telling you, when you have a heart for the lost, you begin to change the way you think. So we're trying to figure out how I can come up with $1,100 to pay for her to get the surgery and get the treatment she needs that could save her life. $1,100 is nothing to pay to save somebody's life. And so we're going to figure it out. I'm not asking for money. I'm just saying my heart is breaking for the lost, people. And I don't want to be a part of something that is not going after it. So we need to understand, as I listened to this story, and I listened to this story about this acquaintance, and I thought about these signs. You might be a younger brother, and that first one is, if you're living separate from the Father. If you're living separate from the Father, in Luke chapter 15, it says, Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to the father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. You see, as I listen to this story about this acquaintance, oh yeah, I know who Jesus is. And I've heard her say, oh, you know, I pray every day. I pray every day. And I challenged her a while back. I said, but do you know the God you praying to? You were so separated from him. You see, this younger son, he knew the father. He knew who he was. He just wanted to keep him at a distance. He just wanted to get away from him. You know, in that day and age, for him to ask for his father to give him his inheritance was saying, I wish you were dead. See, so many people live life this way. They want the perks of being a son, they just don't want the responsibility. They want the privilege of being a son, they just don't want the personal relationship. Starts in the head, it starts in the heart. When we start questioning. And then all of a sudden, and I look at this story and I look at this family and I go, God is not a genie in a bottle. Yet so many people treat him that way. I believe in God. God's great. I just got to keep him in here. And then when I need him, give me my magic wish. Oh, back in, keep my distance. So many people, younger, a sign that you're heading down this road is you keep God at a distance. Not only do you keep your separation from God, but here's the other thing you do. Keep your separation away from God's people. Oh yeah, I don't want to be hanging out with them Christian people. Especially when you're the younger son that you've been in the house. You understand the benefits of the house. Keep your distance. So a sign that we need to be aware of is living separate from the Father. The second sign that you might be a younger son is that you believe the grass is greener on the other side. That you believe the grass is greener on the other side. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country. He was like, I'm going. Man, I hear over there in this next town, man, they live the life. It is going to be so much better there. You know what that comes from? It comes from a lack of contentment. Comes from that stirring that somebody else has it better than me. Somebody else has more than what I have. I look at this family and I can see that. I can see it all over them. And I think about what they must think when they walk up to my house. We are blessed. We have a really nice house by God's grace. Because both of us as single parents were like trying to figure out how we were going to make it. And we got a really, and I wonder what they think. Are they walking up there going, oh, you guys had it so easy. Look what you have. They don't know our backstory, all of it. They don't know the mud and the garbage that we went through to get to where we're at. See, we were lost. We were prodigals. But when you lack contentment, it's so easy to get it caught up in the comparison game. It's so easy to look what everybody else has and say, oh, the grass is greener over there. I just wished I had what they had. Their life seems so much better, so much easier, so much more fun than what I'm going through. I wished I had it there. I just got to get over to that side of the fence. The grass is so much nicer. I want a better marriage. Man, I look at Tommy and Shannon, and they're so perfect. I mean, they dress and match. Like, they're so in love. I bet you they never, ever, ever have an argument. Never. Man, Dave and Cheryl, I mean, he's just lucky she puts up with him. I sure want that. I so badly want that. Oh, that would be so great to have. Right? Oh, just amazing. So, then all of a sudden we start going, man, my marriage. What's wrong with my marriage? What's wrong? Oh, man. You want a better marriage? Start watering the grass. Start taking care of the grass. Get some weed and feed. Right? Find a place where you can kill the weeds and grow the grass. You got to put some effort into it. Okay? Green grass doesn't just happen. Right? We have green grass in our yard, but I'm starting to see now with the sun coming out, guess what's popping up in the grass? Weeds. I'm like, man, it looks so pretty and green before. Where did those suckers come from? So I got to call the gardener and tell him to take care of that. That goes back to the other series we did, Rich People Problems. You go, man, dude, you got to put some weed and feed on that. But if you want a better life, you want a better marriage, you want a better relationship with those around you, you want a better work relationship, then water it. Do the work to make the grass green. Because guess what? Most of the time, the people on the other side of the fence, they've just sprayed their grass with green spray paint. When you get over there, you actually find out they got more weeds than you had. The third sign that you might be a younger brother is you want the instant gratification over what's right. You want it now over what's right. And there he squandered his wealth in wild living. And after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to be a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. We are in an instant gratification society. Go back to kind of the grass is greener on the other side, right? We want to roll out sod instead of planting seed and working the seed in the soil to make sure it grows. Right? We want that instant. Now, actually, it's not even sod. Now we want turf because we're water conscious. We're drought conscious. So we're going to put turf. Then I don't got to worry about weeds. I don't got to worry about watering it. I don't got to mow it. We want the instant gratification. So many times the younger son, you see it here, he just wanted it now. Without understanding that if he would put in the time and he put in the work, the inheritance that he was going to receive from the Father would have been multiple times greater than what he went and wasted. And how many of you, you've had that person, that friend in your life, that you go, and they just wasted their life. Why are they just wasting their life? Right? You've had that you're just looking at them going, man, you got so much talent. You got so much that could be going for you right. And you're just wasting it on the instant gratification, trying to get all you can now, thinking that there's not going to be anything left. If I don't get it now, I'm never going to experience it. You see, the younger brother, the lost son, he's exchanged the eternal for the temporary. He's exchanged the greatest gift God ever gave us, eternity with him, for what's temporary will fade away. The fourth sign, as the worship team makes their way back, the fourth sign you might be a younger brother is this: if you feel like you need to earn your way back into a relationship with the Father. Verse 17 says, when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and I will go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" You see, a sign that you might be a younger brother is that you would settle for coming back as a servant, not realizing you are a son or a daughter. I shared with you last week that I've lived both, back and forth. I've been the younger son. I've went out and I've did things that I do not speak of from a pulpit. And I've been the older brother. And I've been right here. Told you last week, I spent years in youth ministry, and part of that was this whole idea of earning my way back to the Father's house. If I can just serve you in the lowly ministry of working with teenagers, because that's like the pit. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Actually, I love working with teenagers. Sometimes they're, because I can say things to them that I can't say to you. You know, teenagers start whining and complaining. I just tell them, shut up, get over it. Adults, you can't quite do that with. And people get offended and leave and take their tithe and all that stuff. It's just, it's bad news when you do that. But for years, I worked. And there was this idea of, oh, I got to please my Heavenly Father because of everything that I did in my past. All the garbage I walked through. All the filth in the mud. Some of you know me. Some of you know me from way back then. And you understand what I'm talking about. I was an angry, violent, self-indulgent, some pretty vile names I could call myself for what I was. And I felt like I had to work my way back into this. I felt like I had to somehow, if I could just do enough in ministry that I could get over that. I could please my parents enough because I disappointed them so badly that they would be proud of me. I can remember hearing my dad brag about me to some of his friends one time as I was a youth pastor. Yeah, Tracy's running this thing and he has 500 youths showing up to this skateboarding ramps and BMX ramps and just craziness, and they're sharing the gospel with them. And I was like, whew, earning my way back. And I have. I am the favorite child. It's true. True. It's just true. Don't ask my brothers and sisters. But it's just that idea, and I see so many that are lost. So many younger brothers that sit in services week after week trying to figure out how you can earn your way back in. You can't. You can't. You can't do enough good. The father, when he ran out and he caught the son, he cut him off. He wouldn't let him even complete his repentant prayer that he had rehearsed. And he threw a robe on him. He threw a ring on his finger. He said, "Welcome home, son. Let's throw a party." Son didn't do anything. Couldn't earn his way back in. See, as I talk about these signs, you go, well, that really doesn't apply to me. Yeah, but does it apply to somebody around you? Do you have a heart for the lost? Are you seeing the lost around you? So this morning, as ushers begin to come and they're going to get ready to serve communion, younger brothers, come home. Younger brothers, come home. The Father's waiting to run and grab you. Those that are still in the house, don't leave. If you got those questions running in your mind, you got those doubts going through your life and your head going, this is not for me. That's okay for my dad. That's okay for my parents. That's okay for others. But this is not for me. Oh, please stay in the house. Because I can tell you that what I got from the world is a lot of baggage, a lot of hurt, and a lot of pain. Was it fun? Yeah, there were seasons it was fun. Bible talks about sin is fun for a season. But then there's consequences. Stay in the house. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, just before the ushers serve, I want to ask if there's anybody here that you say, I need to get back to the house. I need to get back to the Father. Because we're getting ready to partake in communion, and I want you to be able to make that decision so you can join with us as we proclaim and declare the Lord's death and resurrection. And as we worship Him, what a great way to come back to the house. Give your life, lay it down. That's what we're begging this young woman. Just go to the cross and lay it down. So what you're doing isn't working. Surrender it. And today you're here and you say, that's me. I need to come back to the house. I need to come home. And you'll raise your hand. I want to pray with you this morning. Anybody here? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, today for those hands that were raised, Father, it is so easy to slip in to the younger son. The role to walk that path. And Lord, as they today they recognize those signs, they see those signs within them, and they're declaring today that I want to come home. Father, I've sinned against you, and I've sinned against all of heaven. And today I just want to come home. Lord, today you wrap your arms around them and say, welcome home. Son, welcome home, daughter. All I have is yours. Welcome home. Welcome home. I'm going to ask the ushers, they're going to begin to serve. The worship team is going to sing. Just a minute, we're going to come back and we're going to partake in communion. If you made that decision today, I encourage you to worship with us in communion this morning as we declare and celebrate the Lord. Would you sing with us as you are receiving?
I cast my mind to Calvary. Jesus bled and died for me. I see who's his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. Sing, oh, praise the name. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore, forevermore.
Instructions. It says, for I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread, and he gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup of wine after the supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this to remember me as often as you drink. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. And it's all because of the grace and the blood that he shed for me. I don't deserve it. I love when Paul wrote in his words, in the scriptures, how he said, I was the chiefest of sinners. I was the worst of the worst. Yet on a road to Damascus, the Father of all the universe, the sustainer of all things, showed up. That bright light hit Paul, and he met Jesus. The friends carried their paralytic friend to a place, to a man they've heard doing miracles. They heard that Jesus was performing miracles. They brought him to this place, and they couldn't get through the front door. So they went up, they tore the roof apart, and they lowered him down right at the feet of Jesus. I've been in that place. We went to that place last year. And you know the amazing thing about that is Jesus didn't say, dude, you are really messed up. What do you think you're doing here in front of me? No. He didn't even tell him to get up and walk. What did he say first? Your sins are forgiven. Then all the older brothers in the house, whoa, you don't know that guy, right? Older brothers in the church do this a lot. Oh, that person's coming to church? God, I don't think God's going to forgive them. Do you know the lifestyle they lived? Jesus knew. And he said, hey, I know you guys are questioning me. Back there in the peanut gallery, you older brothers, just to shut you up, what's easier, for me to forgive his sins or tell him to get up and walk? And so just so you know that I am the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Son of the Most High, get up and walk. And he picked up his mat and he walked out. Now I can imagine as he's walking home thinking, what just happened? I'm walking home. But what he had to understand most of all is I'm forgiven. I'm back in. I'm a son of the Most High. So as we drink this cup, we remember his sacrifice. We remember what he did for us. Don't lose sight of the lost. Don't get so in the house that you become an older brother that's so busy doing that you forget you got lost brothers out there. We're going to talk about that in this series. But I don't want us to be a church that misses out on the opportunities to bring people to the foot of Jesus. Would you stand with me this morning? Lord, I thank you for your body that was broken for us. Lord, I know that there's people within the sound of my voice that need miraculous healings. And so, Lord, I pray that because your body was broken for our iniquities, Lord, that you would bring healing into their lives. Lord, I come against the cancer. I come against the tumors and the diseases. Lord, I come against the physical ailments, Lord, whether it's a shoulder, it's a back, Lord. And I pray for healing in the name of Jesus because your body was sacrificed for us. Would you partake of the cracker? Father, I rejoice with you because today your word says all the angels are celebrating. They're throwing a party in heaven because two people came home. Two people came home this morning. So we're going to celebrate this party with you because of the blood you shed on the cross. There is forgiveness of sins that we don't have to earn it. We just walk into it. So, Lord, we celebrate today for the blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Would you partake of the cup? Lord, we give you praise. We give you worship. Would you sing with us?
And on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Sing your praise the name. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise the name forevermore. O'er endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Oh, praise. Shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the God.
week when we were talking, when Tracy was saying that Mark Twain said this was the greatest story that he believed was ever told, I keep finding myself, I'm like, you know, when the therapist starts talking about different issues, I'm like, that's me. And then they're like, the older brother, well, that's me. Yeah, that's me. And then, oh, what it'd be like the father. Oh, what it'd be like. You know, so I'm finding myself there. Anybody else in that boat as we go through this series? I encourage you this week, pick up your Bible, go to Luke 15 and read those parables this week. It's the challenge this week as you go out and just let that story just start to settle in as we go through this and conclude in the next couple of weeks. But if you made a decision for Christ today or you just need prayer, we're here available to pray with you. You can go to the hub in the back and somebody will be there to pray for you. You can also come down to the front. We'll be available for you there. If you've made a decision for Christ, though, we would love to know about it. If you could tell somebody, sharing that step and saying that you did that today is part of that next step. It's part of solidifying what God did in your heart. Try not to isolate yourself inside. Men, if you are wanting to be a part of the men's conference, it's coming up April 1st and 2nd. James is in the back. He can help you sign up for that. And so we want to encourage you to be a part of that. Thank you so much for coming out to church. I hope that you feel like you got in touch with God. Go this week. Share your faith with others. Love people in your neighborhood. We'll see you next week.